mythological idea of this band called the Smashing Pumpkins. It seemed very obvious to me that if someone could somehow combine everything that they liked about music into like almost like a hodgepodge band, that seemed obvious to me where I wanted to go. So I just picked like my seven favorite bands.
It was just me and Billy and a drum machine, and we demoed, played songs for I don't know how long, 6 months. And then we did a show in this local Polish bar with him on bass, me on guitar, and a drum machine.
Darcy in an argument on the street. We started arguing about the Dan Reed Network.
He was saying, you can tell this band is put together by a record company because look at the way that guy jumps around on stage. Regular people in bands don't jump around on stage like that. And I was like, well, I don't know. I play guitar and I kind of move around on stage a little bit. He's like, oh yeah? Well, I'm looking for a bass player. It's like, here's my number.
I went to see the Pumpkins a couple times when they played with a drum machine, and it was just horrendous. They were horrible. But the songs were really good. I thought Billy was a really good songwriter, and I wanted to work with him, so we just kind of clicked. We never really looked back. We just kind of went for it.
It just stuck. I couldn't shake it.
The name was always there. There was nothing I could do about it. I never made friends with the name.
It's a name that sort of sounds like echoing the Bunnymen. and Echo and the Bunnymen. It's like the dumbest name on earth, but you get a couple of their albums and you're like, yeah, Echo and the Bunnymen, they're rocking.
Please welcome Smashing Pumpkins!
For anybody who knows anything about Chicago, I mean, you have kind of the Wax Tracks, you know, ministry kind of thing.
We weren't with any of those scenes. We weren't cool like the Touch and Go bands.
It was very much this kind of flannel-driven, no guitar solos, three-minute pop songs. And we were playing these like six-minute songs with guitar solos, and we were doing all the wrong things. I think if we had been accepted into the local Chicago music scene community right away, I think we probably would have ended up being a different band. But being outcasts or feeling somewhat outside of the inner core of Chicago music pushed us further away, I think. The album's about pain and spiritual ascension, and people ask if it's a political album. It's not a political album, it's just a personal album. In a weird way, Gish is almost like an instrumental album. You know, it just happens to have singing on it. But the music overpowers the singing in a lot of places. I was trying to say a lot of things that I couldn't really say in kind of intangible, unspeakable ways. So I was capable of doing that with the music. I don't think I was as capable of doing that with words.
This record, I think, was done really quickly. We weren't, and Billy wasn't as experienced in the studio.
I'd never been in that situation, but it was like I knew what I was doing. I knew what I needed to do. I think on a personal level, I probably lost my mind and had a nervous breakdown.
I could never do it over again, and I don't know how we survived it, but I really, really loved that album so much.
We'll be right back. Esta es la semana excepcional de Citroën Eurocasión. Coches usados incluso con menos de un año, de todas las marcas, modelos y precios. Garantía europea hasta 20.
During Siamese Dream was probably the most volatile period we've ever gone through. There was a lot of tension in the band, and to be quite honest, I didn't think we'd make another record after that.
For lack of a better term, I went through some kind of weird musical suicide where it was either continue to try and posture as something that I wasn't or just be myself, which is a sappy, corny rock boy, you know, who likes to write love songs and likes to write rock songs, and, you know, just do it. Don't worry about it. Suddenly, I felt, I picked up your album, looked at it, and went, okay, I'll get this. This looks like a good thing. That's pretty inconceivable.
Thank you.
fact that the album came out of it is one thing, but we learned to like each other again. We reconnected our friendships and found why we were together in the first place and realized that it was all these external things that had driven us apart. And suddenly we found out that there was still a strength, and maybe it had been obscured, but it felt real again.
The world is a vampire!
I think the basic opinion in the band is love playing live, hate the tour.
It's so exhilarating and demoralizing and ego building and ego tearing down all at the same time. When you're on tour and you're constantly having to provide a product for people to ingest, it jades you. Sometimes the music can be the enemy, you know, you're like, and that's not the way it should be.
Everybody sort of romanticizes touring, you know, like, oh man, it's tough. You go out there and you're giving your heart out every night. I mean, you do. You try really hard to play good shows and, you know, play somewhat in time with the music and, you know, you hope you're rocking, but, you know, it's just like anything. You know, it's just music.
Just write it down for you. Because every time I say it, everyone gets that kind of puzzled look that they get when someone pinches them on the butt.
Basketball Land. Baseball City, I think is one of the titles we're kicking around.
It's way too self-conscious.
I think, okay, we're going to record an album now. Where do I start? You know, because it's like trying to climb a mountain. You have the weight of permanence hanging over your head. You know, when you're on stage, right, you're going, well, you know, if I blow this note or I blow this chord, I mean, it's gone. You know, on an album, it's there to be repeated digitally till the end of time. It's very hard for me to talk about how the band works in specific, because any time that I've ever talked about it, it just gets misunderstood, and I end up looking like a Svengali. The mechanics of the music is one thing, but the band, the heart and soul of the band, is another. And what it lacks in one sense, it makes up for in others. And what it's, you know what I mean? Somehow there's a weird balance.
People generally think that he does it all, but the three other personalities in the band definitely shape the music for the better or for the worse.
Billy approached me because he likes certain things that I've done in the past that have broken people's accepted opinions of those particular bands, and he wanted to do exactly that for this band.
Well, he's English, and I don't even want to talk about it. No, he's a great guy.
Flood is very different than Butch. He tends to go for the emotional content of a song, which is really what I try and go for. Where Butch was a little bit more of a perfectionist. Butch wanted flawless performance. Flood wants convincing emotion.
Okay, well, let's do that, because it sounds a bit, it's not much guts to it at the moment.
Right. He's just coming at it from every other angle. And he really embodies the sense of excitement about making records that I really feel. He's got that childlike, you know, like we talk about, you know, it's like how kids talk about baseball players. That's how we talk about albums.
Hey, Blood, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Can I just do this one thing real quick?
Okay.
I just want to see if it works, and if it does, then I'll just know. It'll only take a minute. Everybody knows how to play the rest.
The way we worked in the past was complete, literally assembly line, right? Through the drums, through the bass, through the guitar, through the vocals, through the guitar, through the solo. It's more time effective that way, but it's very...
If you spend a little bit more time on getting the sounds exactly right, then everybody can play it as one, and you might get a greater gain because everybody's playing at the same time.
How is it in the room for everybody playing like that?
Crazy
good?
It actually sounds pretty good, actually.
Working in the rehearsal space was just like going to rehearsal, only it ended up on tape, you know?
At this stage, one would hope that maybe half of what we do here ends up on the record. There's no reason at all why we shouldn't be able to utilize this to the end product.
I think it was really productive, and I hope that everyone agrees with me, because I'd like to do more of that in the future.
Emptiness is loneliness, and loneliness is cleanliness, and cleanliness is godliness, and God is empty, just like...
When you hear the new record, it's like, you know, it's like hitting the reset button on a love affair. It's like, if you spend a lot of time with somebody you love, you tend to get, you know, short-sighted, and you kind of look past what initially attracted you to them, and then, you know, one day they'll do something and you'll say, oh, that's it, you know, that's why. So it's good. Every record, I think, is like a rebirth for us.
Those ties are there whether you like it or not. There's nothing you can do. You can hate them, you know, as much, but, you know, the next second you're going to turn around and feel completely different about it.
This is by far the strongest the band has ever been on a completely internal level. It's not even a get along level, because we've always gotten along pretty well, but there's a different strength in it. Familial is the only word that I could use, really.
These are the people I spend 90% of my time with, so of course we're like brothers and sisters.
You know, all their idiosyncrasies, you have to work, you have to eat with them. And yeah, I suppose it is a family without being like too cheesy about it.
Here's a rubber man, take it, rubber man.
My fear is that, you know, Jimmy Chamberlain plays the hits of the Smashing Pumpkins, featuring, like, you know, I don't know who we would have on lead, like the guy from Radiohead on lead vocals, you know?
I don't know, the other guys are starting to talk about how they feel old and they can't rock anymore.
I would hope we'd mature gracefully, but right now I don't really care. Because thinking about the future and thinking about the past is really a way of avoiding the present. And all I know is that the present right now is very good. I'm very lucky, we're very lucky. And I'm really enjoying what I'm doing.
Melancholy and the infinite sadness. It's really representative of the theme of the record.
It's just another one of those pretentious pumpkin album titles. So, just continuing the long line of pretension. Yeah!
Thank you. I think lyrically, it's probably the strongest record we've ever done. I mean, some of the lyrics that Billy's written on this record have just blown me away. I mean, made me want to weep.
On the first album, I felt that the subject matter was extremely personal. I didn't care if anybody got it. On the second album, I wanted to express what I wanted to express personally, but it was also with a keen eye to communicate. It was like this one, I think the subject matter is a little more worldly.
I mean this in all sincerity. I really wrote this record not really giving to about what anyone was really going to think about it. The constant thing was, does it rock me? Does it rock the band? Because I just don't care.